Vamos.
Yeah, I never liked this place anyway.
Excuse me?
Wow.
Don't mind him, we're just friends.
Harry, good morning.
Good morning.
So you open your Bibles, Exodus chapter 20, Exodus chapter 20. Now, just a review, we've been going over what dispensations are. The word itself just means an administration, a stewardship. And then, as we can see, if we've been following on our chart, there's seven that are laid out. Technically, if you want to consider, there'd be eight. That would be following where it says kingdom at the bottom. If you want to put Revelation 22 as a reference, and then anything beyond the destruction of like the world. And after the great white throne and everybody's cast into death and hell that wasn't found written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And then he creates new heaven, new earth. And then new Jerusalem comes down that is between heaven and earth. And we are basically there forever with the Lord doing I don't know what, but we're basically worshiping, serving the Lord. So that would be technically your eighth one. You wanted to consider that to be a dispensation as well. Exodus 20, beginning at verse 1. Exodus 20. It says, "And God spake these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. And thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Okay, thou shalt not bow down thyself to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and show mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Okay, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is in Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work. Thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. Okay, for in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it, or set it apart, made it distinct, holy. Okay, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's." Okay, and all the people saw the thunderings and the lightnings and the noise of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, and when the people saw it, they removed and stood afar. And then they said unto Moses, "Speak thou with us, and we will hear, but let not God speak with us, lest we die." And then God's going to basically address that. We'll see that again in Deuteronomy chapter 5. All right, so what did we just read? We just read what is typically considered the Ten Commandments, right? If we were to keep reading, he's going to have another 603 commandments that are given specifically. And they're kind of divided up. This is technically what would be considered the moral law, but it's still law. We also have what would be civil law, and then you have ceremonial law as well. And those are just basically law governing how they live as a society. They're nation that's going to be built, which they're not really yet, but God's establishing, and then also ceremonial law, which is basically how they worship God. So he has specifics as far as how they're supposed to worship God. Now you're saying, okay, what's the big deal? What's this all about? Why? How does this pertain to me? How does this help me any? All right, we're looking at how God was dealing with man, and how God has, through the ages, basically dealt with him. And so up to this point, Now, in Romans, I think we covered this last week, was he stated that when the Gentiles do those things by nature, which are written in the law, even though they don't have the law, it's a law unto them. And so God's created us with the knowledge of him. God's created us with the knowledge of how he operates. And so even though we wouldn't have been given the law, in our day and age, we haven't exposed because, okay, we're grafted in. And it's a different age, but rather, if we would have been still during the time period where God is working specifically through Israel to reach the world, then we, in order to be able to have had God's law or God's word available to us, and then we would have had to basically become Jews. And so it wasn't like you couldn't know the grace of God or know God. It's just you would have had to come through Israel to be able to know God. This day and age is the same. It's not through Israel, it's rather through the church. And so God's people, which are called by his name, are those who have received him as, or received Christ as Savior. And so now his institution that he works through to be able to go ahead and give out his word, his laws, his decrees, and everything is basically now the church. Now, it's not that we replace Israel, we're being used in place of Israel, but we are not Israel. In other words, God's promises to Israel are still standing and they're still valid, and the ones that haven't been fulfilled yet will be fulfilled in a future time. Go to Acts chapter 1. Well, you know what? No, go to Isaiah 53. This is kind of skipping quite a number of things. Or technically 52:13 is where the context starts. Chapter 52:13, so it's just a few verses before the beginning of chapter 53. But 52:13, it starts off, okay, behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. This is going to be lifted up. As many were astonished at thee, his visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So shall he sprinkle many nations. The king shall shut their mouths at him, for that which had not been told them shall they see, and that which they had not heard shall they consider. Okay, who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form or comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. Isaiah 53. So, just two verses that we just read, Isaiah 53. Then going into verse 3, it says that he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we did it, and we hid as it were our faces from him, and he was despised and we esteemed him not. He surely hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. And all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Okay, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before shearers is dumb, so openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. Okay, this is Isaiah speaking, so he's speaking transgression of the Jews. And he hath made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in death, because he hath done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. And yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief, and when thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Okay, he shall see of the travail of his soul, of the servant's soul, and he shall be satisfied. God shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide with him a portion of the grain, and he he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he had poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgression, or for the transgressors. Right, so we know this is a prophecy. There's others, in particular, earlier in Isaiah, speaking of a virgin that is going to conceive, and then that the son's going to be born, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, and then which is, you know, God with us. But this is, and also Daniel 9. We look at Daniel 9 as well. There's other prophecies in Jeremiah and further on in Isaiah. But this clearest one as far as who Messiah is, that he's going to come, and then also establishing the fact that, again, grace is not found through keeping of law, but it's going to be the justification that you're going to receive by virtue of the servant's acts. All right, so the servant is going to be killed or cut off. He's going to be basically pour out his soul for an offering before God, and then through his knowledge, in other words, coming to know him, is how we will be justified. Not just Israel, but then also that would extend to us now at this day and age. So go to Acts
1:21.
If you wanted to go, you go back to John chapter 13 also, where he starts telling, but he's going to have to be, Acts 1:1 would have been where, if you wanted to go to John 13. All right, so beginning of verse 1, it says, "Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own, which were in the world, he loved them unto the end." And then they are, at this point, what would be in their Passover meal, their final Passover meal. So you go to 14:1. Okay, like, this is him speaking after he is wash their feet, and then he's telling him about the fact that he's going to have to depart. And then Judas has already left at this point when he's speaking to them, and he's speaking to them that he's going to basically be crucified. And he tells them, you know, "Let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, and I go to prepare a place for you." The place being, well, not to argue, but basically I believe the place here being, as far as this is prior to Abraham's bosom going up and ascending into heaven, so it would be his leading the way, basically, to be able to go ahead and let captive be captive. So in other words, he's preparing for them to be able to go access heaven, because up to this point, anybody dying, even if they would have been believers in him, they would go down into what would be the belly of the earth and into Abraham's bosom or paradise if they were believers. So now he begins telling him with regard to the fact that he's going to die, he's going to suffer a number of things, and then you have everybody's kind of trouble in heart. And that's where we find ourselves. He gives promise of the fact that they're not to leave Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father. He tells them the fact that the Father's going to send another comforter to them. And then what we see is after he dies, the veil that is in the holiest of holies, that separates the holiest place, basically within the Holy of Holies, within the inner sanctum of the tabernacle, is rent in two, have now access basically to God directly. Now, this is immediately after Christ dies. He's not yet risen. 3 days later, he rises from the dead, and then he's going to spend 40 days around communing, showing himself to the disciples. He shows himself at least at one point to over 500 brethren at once, and then he's teaching them concerning the kingdom. And then right before he actually ascends, and then one of the last days of his having taught them concerning the kingdom within those 40 days, he tells them that they're not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, the promise being that the Holy Spirit was going to come to them. And then that's where we pick up in Acts 1, that he tells them, verse 4, and being assembled together with them, commanded that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he had said, ye have heard of me. Okay, for John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Once they were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, what wilt thou, what this time restore the king, again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, Judea, and all Samaria, or in all Judea and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Then when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received them out of their sight. So they were looking up toward heaven as he went, and then behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Okay, so now they return to Jerusalem. They're going to commune there for the next, basically, it would be roughly 10 days. You get the 120 that are going to be praying in the upper room. And then Pentecost comes, the Spirit comes upon them, as we're called in tongues of fire. Peter goes out, preaches, you got a great multitude that are born again. And then you have following at this point in time where they're preaching, and then we see God moving, saving practically what would be almost half this population of Jerusalem, and then even greater amount with the surrounding population of the towns surrounding. And then we see God moving to spread them abroad so that they have the Gentiles also getting reached with the same message, and the Gentiles being born again, exhibiting the same characteristic as far as being filled with the Spirit. They receive the Spirit, then they see that God is not a respecter of persons, and particularly that's what Peter said. So now, okay, what we have is from there a transition from what was God working in particular with this one nation, to all of a sudden now you have this group of people that really are not a nation. Okay, so what is now in this list you see as grace, which I would put as church. If you wanted to line it out, just put it as church. You have now a group of people that God is working through. You've technically always had that, where God works in particular with someone, either a one person or then maybe a group. Up until about, you have where we see on our list where it says promise, he was always basically working through, I guess you could say, humanity as a whole. Well, technically he still is, except he would just isolate himself to just, he would have one person that, I guess, basically found grace to where he would work through to be able to go ahead and disseminate his laws, his teachings, knowledge of him through. And so you always had that godly line going back all the way to, it would have been Abel, but he was killed off, and then you have following that would have been Seth, and Seth's lineage going on down to Noah, and then reestablishing again Noah, and then in particular he would work through Shem's lineage. Though the others wouldn't be excluded, the others would be sought to be reached as well. But he chose, he doesn't really give us a specific reason as to why, other than, I know in particular with Abraham, he knew, he saw that we are in Acts chapter 1, he saw that he would raise his kids right, that he would teach those that would follow him what was proper and instruct them in the ways of God. And that leads us to where we are today. We have the transition from this day and age, basically starting, you could say, at Pentecost, whenever Holy Spirit came, to what is going to be when the rapture of the church happens. So, following government, where you got Abram's call, and then you got the promise given to Abram, and then you have further on down in Exodus, where you have the law that's specifically given. That is all still under government, but those are, you could say, that are subsets. So he starts funneling or narrowing himself as far as who to work through, though the world was to be reached. Go to Esther. Go to the book of Esther.
Exodus with John.
No, Esther.
Esther. Oh, Esther. I'm sorry, I thought you said Exodus.
There's something that's interesting. We'll start at chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "Now it came to pass in the days of Ahasuerus," okay, this is Ahasuerus, "which reigned from India even to Ethiopia over 127 provinces." So basically 127 provinces extending from India to Ethiopia. Question. Where are those borders back then? Geographically, what would be the extent of that?
North Africa, Western Asia.
Yes.
My notes say the India was a province of Punjab and West Pakistan today, and Ethiopia was the country south of Egypt, now part of northern Sudan, not modern Ethiopia.
Yeah, so basically with kind of what Joel said, North Africa all the way to like western Asia. Okay, so you would, if you were to look on a map, the Indus River, it would be kind of like your eastern edge of what would have been India, though technically modern India extends further than that. If you're looking at what this would have been, which empire? Ahasuerus?
Persia, right?
Yes. Okay. So under the Persian Empire, it extended probably to what would have been Western India, the Pakistani border, there, that area. The Punjab area, basically along the Indus River. Quite possibly a little bit further east, but it's roughly always, for most of what I've read, it's always been considered as far as like the Indus River. Go to the end of Esther. Okay, just a quick synopsis. Who's familiar with this book?
Yeah.
All right. For those that maybe aren't too familiar with it, Esther was a Jewish captive in Persia. Okay, she was taken there as a child, and then her uncle was taken. Her parents were killed, so her uncle was killed. And then she was taken to be one of King Ahasuerus' wives because he got tired. He got tired of his old wife Vashti.
Didn't she try to usurp him or deny one of his commands or something like that? Chapter 1.
I wouldn't say usurp him.
Disobey him.
It basically, what happened was he received counsel that because of her disobedience to his request for her to come out to the party that they were throwing, it would disseminate throughout the kingdom that, okay, that means women will get, if you want to use this term, uppity. They're not going to want to obey their husbands. And so that's going to cause a problem for us in the kingdom if they see that the queen is doing that. So let's get rid of her. So that's why it's like, okay, let me get another wife then. And so he has his big pool of women that he gets from within the kingdom. Esther is picked out as one of them, and eventually Esther is actually picked out as what would be as the queen come, you know. And then so anyways, there's a gentleman by the name of Haman that is in the kingdom that doesn't care for her uncle. He doesn't, and as, because she finds out, or because he finds out that her uncle's a Jew, he wants to have all the Jews killed. And so the story goes that he's able to trick the king to make a decree to have all the kills Jew at a certain time. So Mordecai fasts and prays and then declares a fast for the Jewish people there and within the palace and just within their certain knowledge. And so he begs, or he actually asks Esther to go ahead and go before the king to see if he can change her mind, or change if she can change his mind about the decree and do something about this. Ends up being that the Lord works to where Haman basically is killed, and then king sends out the decree that the Jews are to basically arm themselves and to fight back if anybody tries to attack them, and then king sends a decree that if anybody were to attack any of the Jews or whatever, that you know they'd be destroyed. So at this point in time, the Jews during that certain day gain a great victory, and then they set a feast to which is presently Purim. That's what Purim is. Is a festival that they celebrate that the Jews were not annihilated. Okay, there wasn't a Holocaust. A Holocaust was avoided at this day and age from the Persian Empire. But the kingdom in which that would have extended, that there would have been Jews, would have been in the Persian kingdom, extending all the way from North Africa down Ethiopia's northern Sudan, basically, to that Indus River region, or probably even further east in Indus River. There's a point I'm trying to point out. Verse 17 and chapter 8. Verse 17 and chapter 8. Start at verse 16, okay. It says, the Jews had light and gladness and joy and honor. This is because already they've been, they've had victory. They weren't destroyed, okay. God's worked on their behalf. And then, and in every province and in every city, whithersoever the king's commandment and his decree came. Now, mind you, that's every province and every city within the kingdom that stretches all the way from Ethiopia to Indus River Valley and further east, right, going into Pakistan. And his decree came. The Jews had joy and gladness and a feast and a good day. Okay, The people of the land became Jews, for the fear of the Jews fell upon them. Okay, now, which land?
Persia.
Which part of Persia?
All of it.
It just says, okay, many of the people of the land.
The whole kingdom.
Yeah. Okay, so you would have, all right, I don't want to belabor the point. Basically, you have people that, now, they're not ethnic Jews, but they became religious Jews. Okay, so in other words, they converted, became proselytes, as was accorded to them in the law, because they were afraid. They didn't want to be destroyed, because God basically caused fear to fall upon the people of the land. Whereas before they were hated and they were about to be terminated, but God turned things around, turned things over. And then you have many folks there that are now become Jews. So you have all of a sudden a great, not just restoration, but a great multiplication of Jews and a knowledge of God and a knowledge of God's law, all of a sudden extended throughout physically the world, the known world at this point, extending from what would be Indus Valley region all the way down to Ethiopia, right? I guess the point I was trying to show is that God's always been at work, even though he had particularly narrowed himself to work through Israel, and though God's plan for them to be light was primarily for them in obedience. But even in disobedience, God worked to extend light through them to be able to have the knowledge of himself to the world demonstrated and shown. Okay, so now you have, now, of those that were converted to Jews, how many were faithful? Well, I don't know. How many returned? Small remnant returned. We know. Okay, but you still had enough that the knowledge of God was disseminated out to the world and to the regions far beyond the what would be considered outermost parts. Were there folks that were living further east than that? Within the borders? Yeah, probably. Okay, but how would they have gotten the knowledge of God? I would say in part just because of that. Who knows that some of the Jews didn't travel from there into the Silk Road, going further east into, the Far East, into China or whatever. Again, that's all conjecture, but I know for a fact, okay, this, as far as what scripture reads here, is that you had many within the land, and it doesn't specify which part of the land, so you would say always within, I would say, venture in every section of the land. Okay, God was at work to reach mankind, even though he had narrowed himself to work through Abraham's seed, through the Jewish nation, he was still at work always to extend his grace to the world. Okay, he wanted to use him. And it's the same thing that he's doing with us today, even though technically the church doesn't constitute a nation as what Israel does. And even though we are grafted into Israel, his promises are still standing for Israel with regard to their land. I'm not gonna have time for this. I'm gonna go into this next week. Okay. This is something that's interesting. And this is pretty interesting, but why do the Arabs and a lot of the Arab nations hate the Jews? What's their argument?
They claim they stole them.
Yes.
Ishmael was born first.
Okay, that's true too. That is true too. Then, they did. And what do they fear that is going to happen also? They they think they want to take over the whole world. They want to take over all the rest of the land. God's promise to Israel actually extended all the way to what would be Iraq today. Like, greater, technically greater Israel. I want to show you guys on a map. They never really fulfilled their promised land command. Okay, their promise. From promised land. And that's primarily because of their disobedience. But it, had they been obedient to God and had they trusted in God as they should, as he had wanted for them, then their modern state or the land territory which what they would have occupied would have been basically extending all the way to the Euphrates and the Tigris River, okay, in modern Iraq, which divides kind of like your Iraq-Iran border area. Well, technically it's Iraq, but and then as far north as kind of edging in part of Turkey, and then as far south, which would include like basically all of Saudi Arabia and then going into a portion of almost into Egypt. So you have, it's actually like a really large portion that they should have, even though they aren't really seeking that now. And my guess is that during the Millennial Kingdom is that they're gonna have that in addition to what they already presently have, as far as what they were able to conquer with them in the time of the judges, that they never really got further beyond that because of disobedience. It was their argument beyond the fact, okay, yeah, that is a good point, that they okay, Ishmael's first son, and they're not of promise because of Ishmael. And it's just bitterness and jealousy. But even then, that's not all. That would only really constitute the ones that would have been of Ishmael's bloodline, I guess, or Ishmael's lineage. All the others are influenced in large part by them because of Islam, because of the rise of Islam. And so they want to argue on that point too. Anyway, so we see God has always been at work to be able to reach the world. During Esther's time, he was able to extend knowledge of himself. I mean, granted, he's God, so he could extend knowledge of himself however he wants to, but he worked even in Israel's disobedience and in that potential Holocaust to be able to turn it around, to have knowledge of himself disseminated throughout the known world to the far reaches of what would be the ends of the earth, I guess you could say, as in the known world in their kingdom. And so he's trying to do the same today, though we're not, we ourselves are not a nation, okay, we're not a people, we don't have a land that's promised to us. We are grafted in, so we have promises, I guess, that extend to us, being joined in to Israel, but we are not Israel. We don't replace Israel. God's promises to Israel still stand. And we'll see a little bit more of that next week and then go into the tribulation time. Why Israel, even though Christ has come, will be taken up, is going to be permitted, I guess, to go back to a system of worship where they would have had before Messiah came. Okay, and that's because of hardness of heart, because of disobedience on their part, not wanting, basically having rejected Christ wholesale. Okay. Does anybody have any questions?
Comment?
Yes, ma'am.
Comment is they were given honor. Well, the reason they were given honor is because they were defending themselves and then they had to kill somebody. They didn't go out and try to take their land or whatever. They just left it. They just were just defending themselves.
Which time? At the end.
The Jews at Esther during the battle. They didn't take the spoil.
Yeah, they didn't. They didn't, because the thing was they were permitted by the king. I mean, granted, they were still under rule, under Persian rule. So it wasn't, I mean, they were just subjects there, but they wouldn't have been able to defend themselves had not Esther intervened and then the king given that decree for them to be able to go ahead and do so. But yeah, you're right, they didn't take they could have, I guess, but they didn't. And so God blessed there. And honestly, that's pretty interesting. There is in Mizoram and going into Burma, that northeast section of India that borders Burma, around there, there's a group of people that call themselves Jews, or at least followers of the Jews God, like present day. It's pretty interesting. So there, I don't know. That's neither here nor there. But that's pretty interesting. Even there's a remnant of that, and there's remnant to. Well, in Sudan, it's probably been mostly wiped out because they killed off most Christians and then run off those over Christians and Jews. But in Ethiopia, they've had a more storied history. But if I'm not mistaken, Haile Selassie, which would have been their last big real king, was born again. Though he wouldn't have, I don't know if he's got Semitic blood or not, but they. He was a Christian, as far as I know. But anyways, all right. Anybody have any questions? All right, so next week we'll be finishing looking at that, going into tribulation, and hopefully going into kingdom from there. All right. We're dismissed.